Ben, you must have been anxious to talk to the family.
I was. Well, that's the first thing they did. They set up so we could call. And it had been 5 years since I'd been home. I'd never had a furlough or anything before the war.
Wow.
And they'd moved. So I called the old address and nobody was there. And I just called the police station and everybody else, you know. And finally I said, oh, I'd got hold of my uncle's number, and I called him, and it was noon, Christmas, or not Christmas, but Sunday afternoon. And they were eating dinner. And they came to the phone. My cousin didn't says, who's this? And I said, well, you won't believe who this is. I said, this is Bud. And she screamed and dropped the telephone.
When you were in Baxter, a reporter for the local newspaper came through. And he came through ostensibly to write about the drawings that you were doing. But you got into a conversation with him about a lot of the things that had happened overseas, the bayonettings, the death march, the prison camps. And he's taking down all of these details. And there was an article published about your drawings and about the things that the Japanese had done to American prisoners of war, Filipino prisoners of war. And that article, you cut that article out and you sent it home to your mother.
Yeah, also the Gazette picked it up.
Billings Gazette picked it up.
But I sent her a clipping from the Spokane Chronicle.
And then after she read it, she wrote a letter, and I've got that letter, and I wonder if you read it for us.
Okay. Well, October 23rd, 1945. Dear Bud, I mean, and this is a letter from Mother. Received your letter and clipping, Bud. Dad and I both cried when we read that clipping. Can't imagine anything like that happening to you. I hope MacArthur orders all those Japs killed there. I am so bitter toward them that I know you have a better feeling too. And more than we could ever know. Well, Bud, I made up my mind I'm going to Spokane. I will leave this weekend and go by bus.
Your mother gets on the bus in Billings and takes that long ride across to Spokane. You know she's what day she's coming in and what time. How did you get to the bus station that day, Ben?
I went on the city bus.
Okay.
And I arrived about an hour ahead of time. I didn't want to be late because this was going to be a big occasion.
What was going through your mind?
Well, I was so excited, really. And because I hadn't seen her for 5 years. And I knew it was going to be an emotional affair.
Were you wearing your uniform?
Oh, yeah.
And were you walking around looking at the...
Yeah, I was walking, pacing the floor, you know, waiting for her to come in. And with great anticipation.
Her bus pulls in.
Yeah.
Where are you? What do you do?
Well, I'm by the bus door waiting for her to get off. And she was pretty close to the front because she was anxious to get off, I guess. And when she got off the bus, I was close to a wall. And I was kind of leaning against the wall, and she came up to me, and she, of course, she was looking me all over expecting to find an arm off or something.
Yeah.
And she said, I want to see you walk across the room. So I walked around the bus station just to, you know, so she could watch me. I said, I'm all right, Mother.
Was that the first thing you said to her?
Yeah. Oh, no. We loved each other, you know, and cried and all that sort of thing.
How did your mother look to you?
Well, she looked a little older.
She did?
Yeah. She'd aged a lot.
Her hair color, I mean...
Yeah, her hair was white and much more so than when I left. Because she went through a rough time. And it was awful hard on her because she kind of blamed herself for me being over there.
Why?
Because she came down to the ranch that time and told me I ought to go in the service. And she kind of blamed herself. So
yeah.
That bothered her all through the war.
When she got off the bus and you're leaning against the wall, did she run up to you and throw her arms around you?
That's the first thing we did,
You did. Did you run to her and...
Oh, sure.
Just hugged her tight?
Oh, yeah.
And did she say anything, like, how you looked to her? Did she say... What were her words?
Well, she was crying.
She was crying.
She couldn't say much, you know.
Was she just saying, but, I mean,
oh,
just...
Oh, yeah, you know, I love you and all that sort of thing. And it was very emotional.
Was that the first time you'd cried?
I think so.
Yeah, yeah. So you hugged her real tight and you walked for her.
That was pretty hard, you know, after getting out of the camps. And I didn't cry very often.
Yeah.
I shed a few tears there.
I can't imagine what that was like, you know?
I didn't outwardly cry, but I shed tears, you know.
When you would see her during those very first days and she would see you, would she touch you? Would she like...
Oh, yeah.
Like, what would she do? Would she like...
Yeah,
would
she
like
just
Ben,
couldn't get enough of me there.
Really? Uh-huh. Because, you know...
Yeah, I know.
Just to make sure it's really you.
Yeah, I'd put her arm, my arm around her. And
you would.
Oh, yeah.
You hugged and kissed her a
lot? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Mother was very special to me. She raised us kids, really. Yeah. And she worked hard. I remember on the scrub boards in the... she depended a lot on me as the oldest boy.
Yeah, and you always said, and your sister said, you, even earlier, that, I mean, she loved all her children.
Oh,
but,
yeah.
But she loved you most. You were her favorite.
Oh, I guess so, you know. I don't want to say that, but I was kind of her favorite.
Yeah. And another thing happened when you were there, because General Wainwright, they had a big parade in the city.
Yeah.
And they put the POWs, you were right behind him in this huge ticker tape parade.
Yeah, we were in convertibles.
Uh-huh.
There was only about 10 of us there.
Yeah.
And heroes of Bataan across big banners, you know. We didn't feel like heroes at all.
Why not?
I don't know. We'd lost the battle. We didn't know how we was going to be accepted when we came back to the States.
What did you think could happen?
Well, we didn't think we'd be heroes, and we didn't consider ourselves that.
Mm.
The heroes are the ones that are buried over there.
A few weeks later, you finally get a chance to come back home to Montana.
And that was November.
In November 19th.
I'd been in the States 2 months.
Yeah. You get furlough. You're on a train coming back to Billings?
Right.
What are you thinking about? What's going
on? Bob Livingston, why I met this friend of mine who had several bottles of whiskey.
Uh-huh.
And he invited me into the car to have a drink, and by the time I got to Billings, I was pretty well loaded. But Laurel, I said, you know, I've got to meet people at the depot. So
yeah.
I better shape up here. And so I got off the plane and I probably smelled like Schindler's Brewery, you know.
So you're at the bus, you're at the train station.
And of course, mother and dad and all these people wanting to hug me, you know. I walked right past my sister. I didn't even recognize her.
What did she
say? And she starts to cry. She says, can't you recognize me? And I said, oh, God, you must be Jean.
The first week or so you're home, one day you're with your mother again. The two of you are alone. And she gives you something.
Yeah.
What?
Well, you know, I always gave the folks my money, you know. I used to work and give them the money during the Depression.
Yeah.
I bought them a car, you know, before the war, which they drove all through the war.
Mm-hmm.
And she figured, I want to give you something, she said.
Yeah.
And she said, this is the only thing I have that has any value.
Uh-huh.
And it's her engagement ring.
That's her engagement ring?
And she had it reset for me on a man's mount there.
That's...
And I've worn with pride for the last 60 years.
Your parents, you said, were living in Broadview, and you used to help your dad with the chores.
Uh-huh.
What was it like to be back out?
Well, you know, I wanted to get on a horse again.
Uh-huh.
So I went out and helped him with the chores and feed the cattle. It was then kind of in the wintertime, and they started feeding them hay, you know. And
mm-hmm.
I helped him pitch off a load of hay to the cattle. Went in, saddled up a horse, and really I know I'm free now, you know. Looking out across the beautiful prairie, and felt so good to get back on a horse again, because that kind of brought it all to a close.